Welcome back to Mad Medicine. In this video, we're going to be discussing vitamin B12 deficiencies and how it relates to anemia. If you guys don't know, on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/madmedicine, we have a complete playlist for you guys for the hematology oncology section. So go check it out while you're there. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel because we're posting brand new content every single day. And with that being said, let's talk about macrocytic anemias. These are anemias that are classified by an MCV that is going to be greater than 100. Normally, 80 to 100 is a normal MCV, mean corpuscular volume. But in these cases, you're going to have a large red blood cell like we have indicated with the arrow. MCH and MCHC are going to be normal to high in most cases, and macrocytic anemias can be subdivided based off of megaloblasts, which occur due to nuclear deficits, and non-megaloblasts, which occur not because of nuclear deficits, but there are other reasons why. So when it comes to megaloblastic anemias, you can have issues with DNA synthesis and DNA repair. So if there's anything happening with the DNA with nuclear deficits, you will see megaloblastic anemia. Now, we have already talked about folate deficiency. You can watch that video on the playlist. But today, we're going to be discussing vitamin B12, and we're going to continue on with these lectures by talking about orotic aciduria and Fanconi anemia in the upcoming lectures. So these are going to be the megaloblastic anemias. Then you have non-megaloblastic anemias like diamond black fan and liver disease and alcoholism, which contribute to macrocytic anemia, but they do not cause macrocytic anemia due to nuclear deficits. So that's very important to understand. Now, when it comes to vitamin B12, this is a photo of vitamin B12 right here. Vitamin B12 is very important because it's only found in animal byproducts, that's it, or animal products in general. And this is going to play a huge role as we talk more and more about vitamin B12. It is stored in the liver, just like a lot of proteins and a lot of vitamins. It's stored in the liver, and there are several years of reserves in the liver for vitamin B12. Now, that's very important because vitamin B12 and folate often go hand in hand when we're talking about their function. But one thing that's really important to understand is that your folate stores are not as extensive as your vitamin B12 stores. So therefore, folate deficiencies are going to occur a lot faster than vitamin B12 deficiencies. Now, that's very important when it comes to vegans. Vegans don't eat any animal byproducts, and both folate and vitamin B12 are found in animal products. So when it comes to vegans, they're going to develop macrocytic anemias, specifically megaloblastic anemias, very quickly over the span of a few years because they're not taking in any folate or vitamin B12. But the reason why they get this macrocytic anemia, this megaloblastic macrocytic anemia, is not because of vitamin B12 deficiency. Rather, it's because of a folate deficiency. A lack of folate is going to affect your red blood cells and their turnover a lot faster than a lack of vitamin B12, simply because of the fact that you don't have that much folate stores compared to your vitamin B stores in the liver. Now, vitamin B12 is a cofactor for homocysteine methyltransferase and methylmalonyl CoA mutase. That is a mouthful. Essentially, what we're saying is it's important for DNA synthesis. So let's just write that down. Vitamin B12 is a very important cofactor for DNA synthesis, and we are also going to go through this in detail in the biochemistry portion, how vitamin B12 plays a role in DNA synthesis. Now, when it comes to vitamin B12 deficiency, it usually can be caused by several reasons, like pernicious anemia. That is a very important cause where you have decreased production of intrinsic factor. Keep in mind, intrinsic factor is important for vitamin B12 to be absorbed in the gut. Gastric bypass surgery can also lead to a decreased production of intrinsic factor because IF is produced in the stomach. That's what I like to call it, the stomach. Okay, so that's where it comes from. If you have gastric bypass surgery, you will not be producing as much intrinsic factor, or you can be in a state where intrinsic factor is not being produced as much, which leads to decreased vitamin B12 absorption in the gut, in the ileum. In the ileum. And then you can also see resection of the terminal ileum leading to vitamin B12 deficiency. That makes complete sense because vitamin B12 is absorbed in the ileum, and if you resect the terminal ileum, you're going to have decreased absorption of vitamin B12, leading to a vitamin B12 deficiency. Bacterial overgrowth in the ileum can also lead to this simply because they block the transportation of vitamin B12 as well as malabsorption. Same issue. And then finally, one of the main high-yield things you need to know is a worm called Diphyllobothrium latum. This is going to compete for vitamin B12 in the gut. Essentially, that leads to vitamin B12 deficiency. And then you have a vegan diet, like we talked about. This is going to be low yield when it comes to step one. Usually, vegan diets are associated with folate more than they are with vitamin B12. So we're just going to write that here. Folate, it has a greater chance of association than vitamin B12. Okay. So let's talk about deficiency findings. You're going to see macrocytic megaloblastic anemias with hypersegmented neutrophils. Very high yield. That's why we have it in red. Hypersegmented neutrophils. These are slides of hypersegmented neutrophils. Neutrophils usually have about 3 lobes, right? So you're going to see something like this. And what I like to think about in this case, what happens in vitamin B12 deficiency or in folate deficiency, when you have hypersegmented neutrophils, these neutrophils cannot divide further because DNA synthesis is not occurring. So instead of them going from 5 to 4 to essentially 3 lobes in their nucleus, they get stuck at 5 because they cannot move forward, and therefore you get these hypersegmented neutrophils. And it doesn't mean that there are 5 lobes. It looks like here you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It could be more, it could be less. Obviously, the photo is bad quality, but my point is they can't progress further into their mature state, and hence you see these immature neutrophils in the blood system, in the peripheral smear. That's very, very important. You will also see homocystinemia, which increases the risk of a DVT, as well the risk of atherosclerosis. Neurologic symptoms can be present in this case. In folate deficiency, they're not usually present. Remember, we talked about that. But in this case, you'll see reversal of dementia, as well as dysfunction of the spinocerebellar tracts, as well as LCST and the dorsal columns. Now, you will also see increased methylmalonic acid levels in vitamin B12 deficiency. When it comes to diagnosing these patients, you want to use something called the Schilling's test. This is a 4-stage test that differentiates between different causes of vitamin B12 deficiency, whether it's a dietary insufficiency or malabsorption or even an infection. Now, when it comes to stage 1, you're going to give that patient oral vitamin B12 plus intramuscular vitamin B12. Now, patients with pernicious anemia or with a deficiency with absorption, less than 10% of the radio-labeled vitamin B12 is going to be detected in their urine. When it comes to stage 2, vitamin B12 is given with intrinsic factor. Intrinsic factor is used to identify any intestinal or absorption problems that are occurring. So essentially, if you give IF and there's an issue with their stomach, right, and the stomach isn't producing proper intrinsic factor levels, well, this will allow for vitamin B12 to be absorbed in the gut. Now, if you give IF and you give vitamin B12, but there still is not a proper vitamin B12 amount in their bloodstream in circulation, that means that there's something happening with the absorption in the intestines rather than in the stomach. Step 3 or stage 3 is when you give vitamin B12 with antibiotics. You want to give antibiotics in order to identify if a patient has any bacterial overgrowth occurring. If that's the case, the antibiotics will then knock out the bacterial overgrowth, allowing vitamin B12 to be absorbed. If there is not any bacterial overgrowth, vitamin B12 will not be absorbed, and that just lets you know that you have an issue occurring with absorption, aka in the ileum itself, rather than with the bacteria blocking absorption. And then finally, you have stage 4, where vitamin B12 is given with pancreatic enzymes, and this is useful for identifying patients with pancreatic insufficiencies. So essentially, you want to look at what is happening. If you give patients oral vitamin B12 plus intramuscular vitamin B12, and less than 10% of the vitamin B12 is detected in the urine, you can see that this is caused by pernicious anemia that is leading to vitamin B12 deficiency. If you give it with intrinsic factor, you can rule out an absorption problem or a problem with the stomach. If you give it with antibiotics, you can look at bacterial overgrowth or a problem with absorption in the stomach, absorption in the intestines. And then if you give it pancreatic enzymes, you can try to figure out if there is a pancreatic insufficiency occurring that is blocking vitamin B12 from being absorbed. And with that being said, that's all you need to know for step one for vitamin B12 deficiencies and as they relate to anemias. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to the channel. If you guys want us to cover a specific topic, let us know. Comment below in any of these videos. And you can follow us on our social media accounts here and here. And if you guys don't know, this podcast can be found on all your favorite providers. Just search Mad Medicine and we'll pop up.